Living on my From Estadio Caliente in Tijuana, Baja California, this is Playoff Soccer coming to you in English exclusively on Azteca San Diego. My name is Nate Abaurea, joined by my broadcasting colleague Ivan Orozco. Work to do for the home team tonight and then some. It's the Xolos of Club Tijuana taking on Club León in the second leg of this first round Apertura playoff matchup. The first leg going very much in the favor of La Fiera, the visitors this evening from Guanajuato. 3-0 victors on Wednesday night. Xolos, the task is quite simple. They got to score goals. A 3-0 result would mean Xolos would advance to the next round. Again, a very warm hello from me, Nate Abaurea, here at Estadio Caliente. A rainy and wet and windy Saturday evening here in Baja California. Ivan Orozco, as we've said already, plenty of work to do for the home side in red and black this evening.
Right, it's a large deficit coming here in Estadio Caliente, so let's see if Club Tijuana can play the way it played during the regular season, a season where they only lost one match at home, only allowed two goals. So we'll see if Miguel Herrera is going to send that team out there and try to score early on and keep attacking and see if they can prevent any counterattacks for León, because León scores and Club Tijuana has to score five goals if they score one.
Well, we'll get to the official tiebreakers here in a moment. It gets a little bit complex as far as how this game could go. We must point out that history is very much on the side of Los Xolos Cuitles. You go back to that championship winning Apertura 2012 season when Xolos faced off against León, lost the first leg 2-0 at the Nou Camp in Guanajuato, came back home here at Estadio Caliente and won 3-0. That same scoreline 4 years later here this evening would be enough to get Tijuana to the next round of these Apertura playoffs. We'll run down the starting lineups now. The starting lineups, first off, for the home side in red and black. Three changes in personnel for manager Miguel Herrera. We'll get to those in a moment. Right now, the starting lineup, a 5-2-3 formation. Again, another changeup from Piojo. Federico Villar stays in goal wearing the number 33, the 39-year-old Argentine Xolos goalkeeper. Five-man back line from left to right of Damian Perez, Emmanuel Aguilera, Topo Valenzuela, Yasser Corona, and Juan Carlos Nunez. Guido Rodriguez holding down things in the center of the park with Juninho just ahead of him, and a three-man front line from left to right of Aviles Hurtado, Milton Caraglio, and Dairo Moreno. The lineup for the visitors managed by Javier Torrente, who took over for the fired Luis Fernando Tena back on August 28th. As León manager, Javier Torrente has not lost. What a run it has been for Torrente. Six wins and four draws to close out the league campaign that saw León in dead last in 18th place back on August 28th when Torrente himself took over. What a run it's been. 6-4 to close out the six wins, four draws, and no losses to close out the regular season. Tack on a 3-0 victory on Wednesday night in the first leg of this playoff tie with the Xolos. 4-2-3-1 formation and the exact same set of personnel for León. William Yarbrough in goal. Four-man back line from left to right of Efraín Velarde, Guillermo Berlizo, Diego Novaretti, and Fernando Navarro Moran. Two center defensive midfielders, Leonel López González and Alexander Mejia. Luis Montes attacking out left. Elias Hernandez attacking out right. Germán Cano positioned right behind the main man up top. And that main man up top, his name is Mauro Boselli. León are kicking off, attacking from right to left, wearing the light green strips with the white accents and the white shorts and the white socks. Xolos wearing the red tops with the white numbers, the black shorts, and the red socks, defending the goal to our left in this first half, attacking their most passionate supporters in La Masacre here in the first half. Xolos, they must score, and they must be clean defensively this evening. We are underway here at Estadio Caliente. Another very warm good evening from me, Nate Abaurea, joined again by Ivan Orozco. And Ivan, three changes for Piojo this evening and a change in formation.
Right. It'll be interesting to see how this formation, how these changes play out for Herrera and the Xolos. We have Casher Corona and Juan Carlos Nunez coming in on the defensive side with Michael Orozco stepping out, who started in the last game. And we also have on the bench Gabriel Auche, who's out there. We have Juninho playing the midfield there. Juninho, a player who with the LA Galaxy shows some signs that he can control the ball, control midfield, and distribute balls upfield. So maybe that's what Herrera's looking for here tonight, to have somebody that can help Guido Rodriguez after Rodriguez recovers balls, send him up forward. So we'll see how this works out, Nate. It'll be an exciting playoff match.
I remember sitting right here in this very booth talking about the comeback effort for Juninho this season. He struggled so much with injury since joining this Cholos team from the Los Angeles Galaxy. He was a fan favorite up there at the StubHub Center, and the fans really embraced him here in Tijuana. Unfortunately, the soccer gods didn't exactly embrace Juninho the way he would have hoped. Injuries have really plagued this season, but he got healthy at the right time, got in a good run of form towards the end of the season, and Piojo most definitely noticed. And got to say, I know both of us are quite surprised, and I'm sure quite a few thousands of people around the stadium are surprised that Gabriel Lauche is not in the lineup this evening.
Right, he's a player that fights for every ball, guy who can play either side of the wings, and a very speedy player who fights and wins balls when needed, and also can come back and defend. He, without him there and without Kevin Gutierrez in the middle, we'll see how this plays out with Juninho out there and Yoser Corona defending in the back, helping Nunez and the rest of the back line.
Again, Gutierrez, Auche, and Orozco, the three sacrificial lambs as far as the changeover in lineup. All three of those gentlemen could play a role here this evening. They're all on the substitutes bench. Mauro Boselli, his first touch in the final third, a lovely little flick through. This is turned into a half chance for the visitors, but it's going to end up in the hands of Federico Villar. We played 2 minutes and tight, cagey stuff early on, and that suits Leon just fine. Again, they hold a 3-0 aggregate advantage. Cholos must score 3 goals this evening, at least if they are to advance to the semifinals of this Apertura 2016 Liga, Ivan.
One of the goal scorers in that first leg in Leon was Rosselli, who a lot of people thought he might not be playing tonight because he was injured in that game and came out. Had to be subbed for of an injury, but he's in the lineup, probably last-minute addition there, and we'll see how he plays out.
Oh, a terrible error there early on. Looked like Damian Perez looking to get that one back to Villar. Villar clapping his hands, saying, let's go, pick it up. An early goal for Leon would just be a disaster for Cholos. Talked so much with the fans in the parking lot outside this game, talked with all the pundits surrounding this game and the journalists covering this game, how important an early goal for Cholos would be, how much that could change the tides here this evening. An early goal for Leon would do the exact opposite. It would mean that Cholos would have to score 5 in order to advance.
Right, as we see the corner kick here.
Comes the corner, it's overhit. Flick on header, back out off the head of Yasser Corona. Leon retained possession, gets this one back out.
And Nate Leon is coming out the same way he came out in the first match, attacking on the wings.
Direct and on fire, and this one is knocked out. It's going to be a second corner kick for Leon in these opening 3.5 minutes. The team that you would think would be playing a little bit more cautiously, conservatively, saying, that ain't us. Javier Torrente is an attacking-minded manager as you are ever going to find. What a run it's been since he took over for the fired Luis Fernando Tena. Back in late August, Leon have been one of the best teams in all of Mexico since that takeover. Villar collects this corner kick and says, let's get a move on, boys. Federico Villar launches this one for Dairo Moreno. It's a good attempt. It's a little bit overhit. Dairo gives chase. It's out of play. 4 minutes gone. 0-0. Cholos and Leon coming to you via the SAP function on your televisions. Azteca America San Diego, pleasure and a privilege to be with you this evening. Live from Estadio Caliente, high above the artificial playing surface, the only one in the Mexican top flight. And it's also a very wet surface this evening, a relatively, call it a medium rainstorm that hit the San Diego and Tijuana areas late this afternoon, and a couple of hours of steady downpour, but the skies have cleared for the time being. Aviles Hurtado trying to bring the fire to the field, dry this thing out with his heat. Good chase back there. Topo Valenzuela drifting out wide and getting this one back to Villar. Villar's got to be careful here. Did not have one of his finer evenings, to say the least, on Wednesday in that 3-0 defeat. Juninho pressing forward for the men in red, black, and white. Interesting to see Juninho and Guido Rodriguez partner up. They have not played together much this season. Obviously, Juninho hasn't played much at all this season, and getting the start here in the second leg playoff tie. It's going to be a free kick and a rather dangerous area, and a little comical moment there at the end of it. A little Leon on Leon violence.
Yeah, you see there's a fiery atmosphere here at the stadium that's coming down the field as well. The players can feel it. Talking about the rain earlier, the under-17 team, the Club Tijuana beat lost 2-1 to Tigres, but went ahead and advanced with a 4-3 aggregate. And it was coming down when they were playing. We were wondering how that was going to affect that game, and we'll see how that affects this one.
Well, look out for León. It's Baselli making a run here on this near side. Baselli threw it. Villar, he chips, and Villar goes up and saves with one hand, rolls out to himself, and bombs clear, trying to find Milton Caraglio. Incredible opening chance there. First of the game for León. Baselli a little nonchalant there. Going for the audacious chip. Maybe would have been better served. Trying to just hit one low past Villar, who'd come way off of his line. Ended up grabbing that thing with one hand. Right. Saying, you want to be cocky? I can do that too.
Right, Villar had none, didn't want any of that, but Baselli did have a better opportunity to either go low or wait for somebody to come and help him there. But Villar's experience there, standing there, waited for that shot and handled it cleanly with that one hand.
Alexander Mejia. Now, the offside flag should have been raised there. The entire stadium thought so as well. We play on, and now Caraglio, who was just banged around all night on Wednesday. Talked about Federico Villar not having one of his finer performances this season in goal for Cholos. As this is an early foul from Guido Rodriguez, and it's going to be an early yellow card for Guido Rodriguez. Seventh minute. A yellow to Guido. We'll see on the replay here. Just not a good challenge. That was actually the first challenge there from Juan Carlos Nunez. Then the yellow card came to Guido Rodriguez for the sliding challenge that came moments later. Miguel Herrera already getting a talking to from the fourth official this evening, being told to get back into his coach's box.
Oh, do you see this? The side just telling the referee, and I think he just kicked Herrera out. I think he just sent them off.
Oh, what on earth is happening here? Miguel Herrera is up in the face of the fourth official. The fourth official is Jorge Antonio Perez Duran. And now, Milton Caraglio's got to be careful here. You see the officials having a conference here. Darryl Moreno's got to be rather careful as well. Luis Enrique Santander Aguirre is the referee this evening. Man coming over, holding the ball in his left hand there. The fourth official, Jorge Antonio Perez Duran, who has reffed a couple of Cholos games this season. He has been in the center for a couple of Cholos affairs this season. He's the one going at it with Miguel Herrera right now. He was the one originally.
Right, he called over the center referee and told him, you know, Luis Enrique Santander called him over and said, we need this guy to get out of here because Miguel was right in his face. He came out of his coaching box. But Miguel Herrera was not happy what was going on there.
It was the initial yellow card against Guido Rodriguez. There didn't seem frankly all too much wrong with that decision. And we'll see if it was Piojo who actually is getting the boot here or if it was a Cholos player on the bench who's getting the boot. Piojo still having the conversation with the fourth official. There's the linesman over here on the near side as well. Juan Carlos Salinas.
Now Piojo's going off. You can see Diego Ramirez, his right-hand man, telling him to walk off the pitch. So Ramirez is going to take over as coach here for the time being. Well, Ramirez is walking too, so I wonder what happened there.
Unbelievable. Miguel Herrera sent off less than 10 minutes into the second leg of this playoff tie with La Fiera of Guanajuato. León definitely got the psychological advantage coming into this contest, and we'll see if the ejection of Herrera has any sort of effect on that, if it can pump up the Cholos players, or if it just provides even more advantageous type things to the visitors in green and white.
Some crazy things have happened to this stadium, Nate, so we'll see how the players respond to that.
Wild beginnings here on and off the pitch. Caraglio gets up, heads this one down. Dairo pokes it away from Yarborough. That's got to be a penalty. The referee is waving away the claims. Dairo Moreno and three of the Cholos players are surrounding.
Yeah, the players got to get back to playing and complain later.
Luis Enrique Santander Aguirre surrounded by Cholos players who are putting their hands all over him. By the letter of the law, there are multiple Cholos players who can be sent out of this game right now. And now, the linesman here on this near side is telling the center official
it's
that
a PK.
It was a penalty.
He is calling it a PK.
That the linesman was actually the one giving the call. The center official has every right to wave off the linesman the way that it seemed he did. And we moved on with life. We played on for a few seconds there. Eventually, Santander looked over to the linesman here on the near side. We'll get a replay here as Moreno poked that thing away from William Yarborough. William Yarborough then took out Aviles Hurtado. The León players could very much make a claim that Daryl Moreno was guilty of an infraction there, poking the ball out of the hands of William Yarborough in the first place.
Right. Usually the referee blows the whistle once the goalkeeper has it, but he never had control.
He never had full control there. The ball is live as Yarborough's leg whips around and the hand reaches out. It trips up Aviles Hurtado. It seems to be a stonewall penalty. That's what you thought, but Daryl Moreno and a couple other Cholos players, when it seemed as if that call wasn't going to go through, they surrounded the ref, crowded the ref, were bumping into his chest, almost bumping him on the shoulders. They're very lucky to get any cards dished out themselves.
Here you see it again. Yarborough's right hand hits the right leg of Aviles Hurtado, and then his leg whips through and takes him down. So now we have the side judge talking to...
Well, the linesman is talking to Baselli down here. Salinas, the near side linesman, now is tasked here in this situation with making sure William Yarborough stays on his line. It's going to be Daryl Moreno to take this kick. Talk about chaos. Talk about a wild start here at Estadio Caliente. We spoke so much about how important an early goal could be for Cholos. Well, here is a fantastic opportunity for the home side. It's Daryl Moreno. Against William Yarborough. Dairo pauses. Another hesitation. Goes down the middle and makes Yarborough look silly in the process. Cholos are back in this thing. 1-0 early. 3-1 down on the aggregate. What a start. 13 minutes in here in Tijuana. Still plenty of work to do for the home side in red, black, and white. But you see Dairo Moreno pumping up this crowd. 27,000 strong. Absolutely loving it as León get us back underway. What a beginning. What a first chapter to this book.
You see there on the replay, he just froze Yarborough there with a little pause. Looks to the right, flakes to the left, taps it in. Right to Yarborough's right-hand side.
Nothing Yarborough can do in the end of it. Dairo. Get another look at that there. Almost hard to believe that is how Cholos get their first goal, not only of this game, but of this two-leg tie. Listen to Estadio Caliente come alive. Baselli goes to ground here, and you see Yasser Corona calming everybody down.
The crowd's right into it, too, that moment when Miguel Herrera was arguing with the referee just sparked everyone in the stadium, and Estadio Caliente has been as loud as it's been in playoff matches.
Oh, and Caraglio is taken out by his fellow Argentine, Guillermo Burdizzo, and Burdizzo is shown a yellow card, 15th minute caution. Miguel Herrera there coming up into the stands moments ago. Crowd going wild as Piojo was walking up with La Gente. He's down right below where we are up here in the broadcast booth. Amazing stuff. Wild stuff. Absolutely unreal. The first quarter of an hour here at the Estadio Caliente. You want action. You want excitement. You want craziness. As Yasser Corona gets this one out to Damian Perez. 1-0 Cholos. They still need two more and a clean defensive slate for the rest of the night if they are to go through. If León are to get one goal back here, Cholos would have to score five on the night at least.
And here we see Yasser Corona making those plays that Miguel Herrera wanted him to play. In the back end there, recovering balls and sending them forward. Looks like Miguel Herrera has the best seat in the house right there in the stands. Never seen a coach come down low, that far low in the stands in the stadium. Usually up in the box.
Down as one of the people. Absolutely incredible. Miguel Herrera ejected from this game in the ninth minute. Just a couple of minutes later, he sees Dairo Moreno score from the penalty spot. Give the side a 1-0 lead on the night. That's got to be a foul on Juninho. The way this game has gone, it very well could be a card. Oh, my goodness. It's a red card for Juninho. Juninho's been sent off. 17th minute.
There's
and
the replay.
Yet another twist in the tie.
He took the cleats high into the thigh. That'll probably draw a red card with the cleats up.
Juninho called for the studs over challenge to the mid-thigh area of Alexander Mejia, the 28-year-old from Barranquilla, Colombia, went straight down under the challenge of the Brazilian playmaker. And the aforementioned Brazilian playmaker is now done for the evening. And perhaps, depending on how this thing plays out for the season, in addition to all of his teammates, of course.
That could very well be a key for León right there, to be a man up. And then a man like Juninho, who was in the help control pace of the match at midfield, not having him there could make the big difference here.
17th minute, Juninho sent off, straight red card, studs over challenge. And the Colombian midfielder wearing the number 13 kit, Alexander Mejia. We see it one more time here. He just left it in far too long, far too late. You see, if he pulls back right there, he maybe gets away with it. The fact that it's on the far leg of Mejia just adds to the consequence there. And you thought, surely it was going to be a card. Myself, I was thinking we were going to see a yellow. Luis Enrique Santander Aguirre instead. The referee who has already been in the midst of so much chaos. We haven't even played 20 minutes yet this evening. He shows the red, Ivan, and Cholos have now lost their coach and one of their central midfielders.
Right. But looking at the replay, I wonder if Juninho was trying to get the ball. He did hit the ball, and then after that he hit the player there. But I guess that's when he was arguing, that he was going after the ball, and the player came in and ran into his foot. But it looked like a foul from up here, at least a yellow card.
At least a yellow, maybe a bit harsh with the red, but the studs were up, and it was in the mid-thigh area of Mejia. You could very much see that, given as a red card all around the world.
So that's three ejections for Club Tijuana, including Diego Ramirez, the backup, the assistant coach. He was sent off along with Herrera. So that's three red cards for Club Tijuana here with less than 20 minutes in the first half.
Diego Ramirez very much looked at as the consigliere, shall we say, for Miguel Herrera, the right-hand man, the confidant. So not only are Cholos without their head coach, Miguel Herrera, but Diego Ramirez also shown the boot back in the ninth minute after that chaos here on the near side touchline. I feel like far more damaging. Cholos obviously losing a player on the field, but could they get a goal from a set piece here? Oh, it was Corona, and it looked like Aviles Hurtado going up for it. The offside flag was up on the near side. It would not have counted. Communication has got to be better, though, between those two as they both went for the same aerial attempt. Looked like they kind of got in each other's way there at the end of it. Yarbrough, he's going to have this one up the edge of the 18-yard box, ready to boom clear. 20th minute, Cholos 1, León 0. Nate Abarrea and Ivan Orozco coming to you from Estadio Caliente in Tijuana, Baja California. Second leg of this two-leg playoff tie between two teams that packed quite a few events into a very short amount of time, going back to the second division of Mexican soccer. We'll get back to that here in a moment. Cries for offside. They're not heard. This one is headed out. Looked like by Football Valenzuela. León continue to press. And then Lopez Gonzalez was on it. He loses out. Aviles Hurtado tried to poke ahead to Milton Caraglio. Beg your pardon, it was Guido Rodriguez up there. Let's remember Guido Rodriguez on a yellow card. Challenge back in the seventh minute.
I wonder if having a little more space there, I mean, feels going to help Tijuana with that, with Juninho being gone there. If you see Guido Rodriguez moving up a little bit more than usual. We'll see how that plays out, Nate.
And we'll see what it means to the tired legs of Cholos, especially someone like Guido Rodriguez, who's now going to be tasked with oh so much more than he would have, obviously, if this game would have been even up 11-11. Guido Rodriguez may cover more ground than he ever has this entire season. The 22-year-old Argentine, who has just been a spark plug for this Cholos team all season long. Here he is on the ball in the center circle. Guido Rodriguez, a guy who would customarily like to sit back a little deeper, play that true center defensive midfield role. Now with the way this thing's gone, Miguel Herrera playing that 5-2-3 formation, we'll call it, from the start. Things are definitely changing around quite a bit. It looks as if Damian Perez and the other outside back, Juan Carlos Nunez, are basically pushed up as wingers now. This one is a back heel up to Caraglio. Lovely stuff from Guido Rodriguez on cue, covering oh so much ground and coming over to the near side. Going straight at defenders 1v1, not exactly a strength of Milton Caraglio. And Aviles Hurtado is just standing offside. The flag goes up. Yarbrough is going to take his time to get us back underway.
Right, now we're going to see how important it's going to be for players like Dairo Moreno and Aviles Hurtado to come back and help on the defensive end of the game and then come right back up and find a position to receive a ball from the back. So we'll see how that comes about, see what kind of endurance they have to be able to accomplish that tonight.
Ivan, we talk about the rivalry between these two sides. So many people in this stadium know it oh so well. They look at León really as the, if there is one, for a club that was only founded 9 years ago, if there is a quote-unquote rival for Club Tijuana, it is very much La Fiera. It is very much this very León team. And you go back to the lower divisions and some crazy backstories going back to 2010 and 2011 and then in the top flight in the Apertura of 2012 when they matched up for the first time in the Liga MX playoffs back in November of 2012. Unforgettable two-leg tie that was that started with León having a dominant 2-0 victory at Estadio Camp Nou in Guanajuato. Tijuana came back here to Estadio Caliente, won 3-0, and advanced to the championship game where they beat Toluca over two legs to win their first ever championship in Liga MX. Obviously, if history were to repeat itself this evening, a 3-0 result, it would be enough in very different circumstances, albeit 4 years later, but that 3-0 result would be enough. The away goals tiebreaker is the first tiebreaker used here in the Liga. See, Guido Rodriguez caught a little bit out of position. That's what we got to watch out for. Cholos have to watch out for, but Guido Rodriguez very much has to watch out for. Look out over on this far side as this one's blasted across the face, and it's cleared out by Aguilera. Errol Moreno goes up for this header, wins it. Aviles Hurtado knocked to the ground. Is that going to be a card for Mejia? Manu was the brunt of that challenge from Juninho that saw the Brazilian sent off back in the 17th minute. It is not a card. It will be a free kick for Cholos as this thing slows down ever so slightly. We see the replay here. Aviles Hurtado was just swung on with an errant elbow there. A little shoulder knocking Aviles to the floor. But real quickly finishing up, Ivan, going back to that 2012 season. What a night it was here at Estadio Caliente. One of the most famous nights in the young history of the stadium and of this club was that 3-0 win in the second leg to win on aggregate 3-2. And then what did they do in the next round? They ended up winning the championship.
Right. When you ask players who were on that team, you know, what was the best moment of your season that year? They mentioned not the title. They were happy they won the title, but they mentioned the key moment is playing against León in that match in the semifinals here and be able to mount that comeback and get 3-0. And it meant a lot more because it was against León, a team that there's no love lost between these two teams. And they had some crazy, crazy matches in the Segunda, in the second division, in the Ascenso League. So to be able to beat them and eliminate them, it was quite crazy for them. And Nate, if you remember, there was twice in the regular season, vice versa. Each team kept each other out of the playoffs. Mm-hmm. So that even intensified the rivalry in the first division.
Going back to the last time these teams played here at Estadio Caliente, as Aviles Hurtado tries to send this one in towards Caraglio. Cleared halfway out. And now look out here as Luis Montes is on the ball in space, poking forward to Baselli. Montes, one little give and go. His initial pass to Baselli was off the mark. Prevented that from really being possible there. Cano pokes ahead. Leonel Lopez Gonzalez. This one eventually trickles through into the hands of Federico Villar. The last time these two teams played here in Tijuana was a 2-0 victory for Cholos back on August the 12th. A game that saw León hit either the post or crossbar five separate times. That was right during the worst of the downspell this season for León that saw them mired in a deep, deep slump. and placed in 18th, dead last, the basement of the Liga MX table for almost the entire first half of this season. What a change a manager can make. Javier Torrente took over again for the fired Luis Fernando Tena on August 28th. Since then, in Liga MX play, including that first leg playoff win 3-0 back on Wednesday night against these Cholos, 7 wins, 4 draws, and no losses for Javier Torrente as León manager.
Right, León is getting got hot at the right time. Got the number 8 seed, the last playoff seed to get in. But did you notice Wednesday night, they were dangerous, and they're still dangerous. They've done it before. They've taken that number 8 seed and won a title with it. So
did it back in the Clausura of 2014 with Gustavo Matosas as the manager. Incredible two-leg championship victory, actually, over Los Tuzos of Pachuca back in May of 2014, and they did exactly that. They got hot at the right time. They snuck into the playoffs, same way you'll see in various American sporting leagues. It's not exactly how you start. It's how you finish the regular season, how you go in to the playoffs, how you go in to this Liguilla, and you'd very much say the opposite as far as the form of Cholos. This is a team that has lost 3 games in a row. Hard to believe that when you really think of it. Just in those simple terms, Cholos, a team that lost just once here at home all season, that 1-0 loss to Tigres back earlier this month of November. They've lost 3 matches in a row in the league.
And they went, 11 games unbeaten?
11 games unbeaten in a 17-match regular season. They lost the final 2 league matches here at home against Tigres, away to Veracruz, basically backed in to that one spot. People were very surprised that neither Pachuca nor Tigres could do enough at the end to actually claim the top spot, the top seed, but maybe that was a blessing in disguise for Tuca Ferretti and Tigres and the folks at Pachuca, because León might be the hottest team in these here playoffs. And you see it by the way they played in that first leg. You saw it by the way they came out in the opening 5 or 6 minutes, but then this thing, if it was at a simmer, went to a full overflowing boil after about the 7th minute, after a 2.5 minute or so delay. Miguel Herrera, as well as Diego Ramirez, his assistant manager, were shown their marching orders, ejected from the contest. A wild sequence ensued a few minutes later when Tijuana thought they should have a penalty called. It seemed as if the penalty was not called. Dairo Moreno and a couple of Cholos players crowded the referee, were bumping into him, downright shoving Luis Enrique Santander Aguirre. Suddenly, Aguirre looked over at his linesman and said, penalty. The León players were then incensed. Dairo Moreno scored from the spot on an audacious, pretty much straight roller down the middle. Put William Yarborough, looking funky on one knee, made the score 1-0. The stadium was absolutely lit up. Cholos had just what the doctor ordered in terms of competitive talk. They needed an early goal to have a chance in this game. They trailed 3-1 on the aggregate, same way they do now here in the 29th minute. But then, in the 17th minute, just 3 minutes after that goal was scored from the penalty spot by Dairo Moreno, Juninho is getting one of his first starts of the season. Juninho only started 1 game this entire season, got the start here in the second leg of this playoff tie against León, and Juninho shown a straight red card for a studs over challenge to the upper thigh of Alexander Mejia in the 17th minute.
Very dramatic start to this match, but nevertheless, never a dull moment here in Estadio Caliente, as we see Club Tijuana is trying to create spaces, trying to move the ball, something they couldn't do in León, control the ball. León controlled most of the ball, most of the match, and like Herrera said in this news conference, if we can't have the ball, we can't score, so that's what they're trying to do, trying to keep the ball moving, even with 10 men.
Even with 10 men, and gotta say, the man advantage is not exactly been in bold print for León since that red card to Juninho back in the 17th minute. Cholos have held their own since Juninho was shown his marching orders. However, look out as this evening progresses, because those tired legs that we talked about very much play a role. And you look at Guido Rodriguez already stretching himself out here in the center of the park. He's going to have to cover a whole lot more ground. These Cholos players are going to have to be that much more filled with effort, filled with quickness. And all those training sessions, all those two-a-days way back when, all those various strenuous activities in regards to conditioning for this team. And we've seen if you follow Cholos on social media, you've seen all of that conditioning going on throughout this season. Hey, this is what it's all about. This is what you saved all that stuff up for. Down a man in the 17th minute in a game where you still need to score two more goals and have a clean slate defensively. This is where proper conditioning comes into play, Ivan.
Right, you can give Coach Kiver Becerra, our fitness coach, credit for that, and Sergio Gonzalez for keeping the team in top shape and keeping them healthy and be able to move properly on the field. But one thing you got to take into account, too, is this is the playoffs. It's two games per week. So typically you play one game a week, and this time you travel to Central Mexico, 1,500 miles, and then back to Tijuana on a short week, and can take a toll. But here we go. We'll see. This is what where championship teams make a difference. We'll see which one of these two teams proves championship worthy.
Two games in 4 days for these two teams. León going with the exact same starting 11 that they went with in that 3-0 victory on Wednesday night. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. You ever heard that one before? León getting back in possession here. We have not seen too much of this. We saw quite a bit of it back on Wednesday night. This one is going to roll into the hands of Ilar. Federico moves forward, rolls up to his fellow Argentine, Guido Rodriguez. If a player or coach in this contest is not a Mexican by technicality, chances are they are an Argentine. As Milton Caraglio, an Argentine, blasts this one wide with the left foot. Javier Torrente, an Argentine manager for León. Milton Caraglio, the Argentine up top for Cholos. Federico Villar, the Argentine goalkeeper between the pipes for Cholos. Guido Rodriguez, the Argentine midfielder, wearing the number 5 for Cholos. The two center backs for León, Diego Navarrete and Guillermo Berdizo, both Argentine.
It's a Mexican league made of Argentinians.
William Yarborough, what many have called the American Mexican. You hear that terminology for so many men and women being called Mexican Americans. Well, if you take that in a technical sense, in a literal sense, William Yarborough is an American Mexican. He's someone who comes from American descent, who actually grew up in Aguascalientes.
And born there.
Born in Aguascalientes. An American father and a Mexican mother. Look out here. As Cano could be through, Villar's way off his line. Back across the face, it's going to roll harmlessly out of play. Real quickly, finish up on William Yarborough. And born in Aguascalientes. Oh, this one's lost to Luis Montes. Cano gets this one out wide to Elias Hernandez. Elias.
Told us to dodge the bullet there on that one with that mistake by Nunez there in the back.
Sure, what exactly happened there with...
I don't know, but Montes is a dangerous guy, has a dangerous foot. He can bend one from back there and catch Villar off his line.
Well, watching the replay here, Elias Hernandez, the pass is just a little bit off the mark there. You saw him turning back. Not too thrilled with his teammate, but León are back on the front foot now. We'll get back to the story of William Yarborough in a second. It's a mighty good one, but Cholos got to stay focused on their defensive duties here. Milton Caraglio's got to go to the ball. Dairo Moreno is absolutely disgusted here on this near side with his teammate in the center of the park. Lena Lopez Gonzalez. Forward Efraín Velarde. Aviles Hurtado. Back on it now. Dairo Moreno giving chase up this wing. Being hassled by Guillermo Berdizo. Dairo Moreno calling for a ball. Yells to the bench. Give me one. I ain't got time to chase. Time's of the essence this evening. We're in the 35th minute. Cholos are playing like it's the 89th. Can't panic. Can't get too crazy with that. But obviously, there needs to be a real sense of urgency this evening for this Club Tijuana outfit. Aviles Hurtado catches a lucky break. He blasts towards the byline. He plays it across the face, and this one is whiffed on.
Damian Perez rushing in from the left side. Had time to control the ball. Attempts to do a one-timer, and it just was a little too high for him. Couldn't control it there on a nice pass from the right side of Aviles Hurtado. There it is right there, and he tries to one time it with his leg up, but couldn't
watch
get it right.
We watched this again here, Ivan, and not to be too harsh on Damian Perez, but maybe going for a diving header there, maybe trying to use the head to nod that thing back to the far post or to come with something powerful back to that far post, putting it on goal. Like it would have been better served using the head there.
Right, and he had time to try something else other than try to flick it with one foot.
Foul called. Milton Caraglio taken to the floor. to be a free kick for Cholos. William Yarbrough, the Leon goalkeeper, wearing the number 25 on the back of his neon green goalkeeper outfit, played in the youth system for the Mexican national team. This one cleared partway out. Avilés Hurtado is back on it now. Still going through. Caraglio on it. Was Caraglio taken down for a penalty? Oh, they say no.
Goal kick.
They say no. We'll see the replay here. Milton Caraglio may have gone down a little easy. We'll see what happened here. Looked like Caraglio, quite frankly, was just tripped up there. Efraín Velarde, talk about a get-out-of-jail-free card. Maybe the fact that Cholos have already had a penalty called in this game played a role in that not being whistled as a foul inside the area there, but Efraín Velarde has got to consider himself one mighty lucky customer, Ivan, for getting away with that challenge on Caraglio.
Can't see Piojo from here, but I wonder what's going through his head and what he's doing after that no call right there.
Probably can't repeat any of the things that he's saying right now. We'll leave that for another show. Here's Montes. Back to the left back, Efraín Velarde. We were just speaking about there moments ago. Cano loses out. Dairo Moreno pokes up and over Berthiso. I think that was Fernando Navarro-Moran actually out there that had the ball waterfalled over the top.
You see Caraglio showing his footwork, a guy that likes to pass the ball and have his teammates score.
It's Avilés. Hurtado can't get a good service in. This one is cleared only part way. Chance for Juan Carlos Nunez to head this one back in towards Caraglio, playing with his back to goal the way he likes, but just doesn't come off the way that he would have hoped there, and it's been a real rough time of it for Milton Caraglio, going all the way back to the opening whistle at Estadio Camp Nou in Guanajuato on Wednesday night. León have just bossed the big, tall Argentine number 9. And interestingly enough, we carry on that Argentine dialogue with Berthiso. Ooh, is this one? It's cleared out. Dairo Moreno. Chase headed forward. Onside was Elias Hernandez. This one is driven low. Villar gets down, makes the save, hauls it in. Unorthodox, a little bit funky. Federico Villar at his finest. 39 years young. He rolls out wide, and Cholos get back on their way. But Milton Caraglio, who are the two people who've been most responsible for that shutdown performance against Milton Caraglio, making him look, I don't want to, again, be too harsh on Cholos number 9, but had one of his worst games of the season back on Wednesday night, and a lot of the credit for that has got to go to his fellow countrymen. Unfortunately, they're not his teammates here on the club level. That's Guillermo Berthiso and Diego Navarrete. The two tall Argentine center backs for León have shut down the tall Argentine center forward for Cholos. As Guido Rodriguez loses out on this one, a foul is called. Someone on the León side, looks like Mejia, is going to go down here. He's hobbled and holding the back of his ankle. A massacre and Cholos fans.
Well, he's calling for the medics, so it must be a serious injury.
The crowd doesn't like this one.
Right.
And you see, though, Mejia was on his feet, hobbling around, and then chose to go down there. And now the medical cart and medical staff are on the pitch. We're going to have a little bit of a delay here. Not the first one we've had in this first half. Would not be surprised if there are 3, maybe 4, even 5 minutes of added time in this first half. You go back to the delay that saw Miguel Herrera ejected from this game, the Juninho red card, the penalty kick fiasco back in the 11th, 12th, and 13th minutes. There should be a significant amount, at least for first half standards, there should be a significant amount of added time after the scheduled 45. We currently stand in the 40th minute. Mejia down in a heap, and it looks like León may have to go to the bench here. Javier Torrente looking right. Things over.
The stretcher came down pretty fast, trying to get him off the field. I don't know if that's the home side trying to get him out quickly or the injury is pretty serious.
I'm looking for a replay here because we saw Mejia was the recipient of that challenge from Juninho that saw Juninho sent off back in the 17th minute. So I'm actually standing up and then started hobbling, then went to ground. Torrente in a conversation. A couple of his assistants. The stretcher is occupied by the body of Alexander Mejia. He's up on the cart. This does not look good for the 28-year-old Colombian who suited up for Los Cafeteros at the 2014 World Cup in Brazil. Played very well for Colombia in that World Cup. He's played very well for León this season, especially of late. He's been in great form, but it looks like Mejia may be done prematurely this evening. 41st minute. Cholos, all they're concerned about, playing down a man, in case you're just joining us, is getting something out of this set piece. Good idea for the back post there. I mean, Perez now gives chase. Damien tries to look forward to space. It's
fought for that ball.
Did he want to throw on the end of it?
Yes, he won it.
They say yes, Cholos ball. The Leon players don't believe it. Now look out! Could it be two? It is! Cholos 2, Leon 0! They're one goal away.
Jacer Corona with the goal.
From pulling off the impossible comeback, still a long way to go this evening. A 3-0 result would be enough for this Cholos team. And Jacer Corona has gotten them another step of the way there. Leon thought surely that it should have been their throw-in down in the far corner. Damian Perez just said, I'm going to take it. I'm going to assume that it's mine. It seemed like Luis Enrique Santander Aguirre, the center referee, kind of just said, okay, carry on. The León players looked like they weren't exactly ready for that thing to be back underway. Focus lapsed for ever so short of amount of time, and it ends up with a great ball across the face of goal, a great first touch from Jacer Corona, and he blasts it low past William Yarborough into the lineup, onto the score sheet, 2-0 Cholos. They still need another goal to pull this thing off, but load of time left in this game. Darryl Moreno's fouled here on the near side. Unbelievable stuff. 43rd minute. Darryl Moreno rubbing out the brunt of that challenge.
It all started with Damian Perez fighting for that ball after trying to do a self-pass on that left corner. Fighting for the ball, earning the throw-in, and then sending that cross in. Ravilés Hurtado with his back heel, finding Jacer Corona in the back. There's a reason why Herrera brought in Jacer Corona, because he's a defender that has a nose for goal. A guy that can also score, come upfield, and create plays such as that one.
Who's the team playing with 10 men right now? It's the team that's up 2-0 on the night after losing 3-0 on Wednesday. Another goal, and Cholos would be good to go through this one.
There it is! Oh, 3-0!
It's in! It's Guido Rodriguez! Can you feel Estadio Caliente? Go on,
it is
Guido.
Going nuts in here. 43rd minute goal. Guido Rodriguez ties the aggregate. With that, Cholos is in the semifinals. Still got a half to go. What an atmosphere here in Estadio Caliente.
Ivan, if it were to end this way, Cholos would go through. We obviously still have the remainder of this first half and the entire second 45 to go. And judging by the amount of drama that we've seen here in this first half, surely there is plenty more to come. Guido Rodriguez was actually in an offside position when the ball came off of the foot of Darryl Moreno there. He may have been onside off of the flick that looked like it came off of his fellow Argentine, Milton Caraglio. Guido doesn't care. He took the opportunity, blasted one low to the far post past the outstretched and helpless William Yarborough. It's 3-0 Cholos. This is absolutely unbelievable. We talked about it, saying history was on the side of Los Cholos Quintles. Deja vu all over again. History repeating itself. Groundhog Day here in Baja California. León, though, again, they have a man advantage. They have not used it really at all since Juninho was sent off back in the 17th minute. They've got a corner here now. If León were to score a single goal, Cholos would have to score two more. They'd have to win 5-1. Baselli going up for that header. He can't get to it. Avilés Hurtado, that was not a smart play from Avilés there. That was not a good spot.
That's a foul that was not needed there for Tijuana. And mistakes like those result in deadly plays by León. It's a team you can't fool with. With strikers, people that can hit the ball from out there that can easily bend a shot.
Avilés Hurtado.
Oh,
looks like his boot went straight into the head of Guillermo Berdizo. Berdizo down in a heap right now.
Hit in the head with that.
It's a yellow card to Avilés Hurtado. Just not the time, not the place, not the manner for an acrobatic bicycle kick clearance at the top of your own 18. Áviles Hurtado's got to know better than that. There was no need for that there. It's a very dangerous play anywhere in the park. It's just a silly play at the top of your own 18-yard box. It gives away a very promising opportunity to the visitors in green and white.
Right. The man's still down. He took that headshot there. Looks like he got cut, too. A little bit of bleeding. Trainers are trying to control the bleeding there for a little bit. We're going to have a little bit more added time to this crazy wild first half. Probably one of the wildest ones we've had in the Stella Clint for a while. But it's not surprising when you're playing a team like León. These two teams have always created incredible matches, either at this stadium, because we know León dominates at home, but here in Tijuana, the Cholos Quinclos are creating some fantastic first half here. But we'll see how León reacts to it. They have what it takes. They have the man advantage, but they also have the team and the players that can overcome such events of the first half. But we'll see how it plays out.
Guillermo Berdizo is bleeding quite a bit on the right side of his head. We get a shot there. The boo to Áviles Hurtado. Absolutely bludgeoned Berdizo, the former Roma, Boca Juniors, and Galatasaray center back. Looks like a boxer after the 12th round right now. We'll see if Berdizo is able to clean himself up and come back into the game. He's going to go straight to the locker room right now. Not sure if we've seen the last of Guillermo Berdizo this evening or if he'll come back for the second half. For the time being, important to point this out right now, for the time being, you look down there right now, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So it's 10-10, including the goalkeepers right now. Juninho obviously showing the red card back in the 17th minute. Federico Villar is trying to get everybody in line here. A major opportunity for León to get one back. This would be a huge goal for the visitors.
Montes going to shoot it.
Montes! Oh, it's cleared off the line!
Caraglio at the line with the header.
Milton Caraglio! Would you believe that? Your center forward heads one off the line that would have made the score 3-1. And given León the lead on aggregate. This one's headed out by Nunez. Leonel Lopez Gonzalez back out wide. Elias Hernandez. Back into the center. Hurtado back on it now. We've already played well past the scheduled 45. We never got an announcement as far as the extra time. Looked like, I believe we got a word of actually 5 minutes of extra time.
I don't know, just won the corner kick on that one. He's throwing his arms in the sky, trying to get the stadium even more fired up than it already is.
How about a fourth?
That would be intense.
How about a fourth from Cholos, who trailed 3-0 on Marcador Global and the aggregate scoreline coming into this game. The big boys are coming up. Guido Rodriguez in the area. Milton Caraglio's at the near post. Four in the box in red. It's driven low to the near post. It's not a good service from Dairo Moreno. It's out for a throw in over on that far side. León just packing it back right now, trying to really fill the cracks and make sure a fourth doesn't go in before the halftime break. What a first half it's been here at Estadio Caliente. Is there more drama to come before the halftime whistle? Hurtado, so maybe thinking about going for a bicycle kick there to lock that one in.
Another corner kick on that one. Yeah, he would think twice about doing that. Well, they changed it to a goal kick here. It appeared that the referee had pointed to the corner spot. Nate, I wonder what's going on through Coach Javier Torrente's mind, giving up three goals so quickly and randomly in the first half here with a team that only has 10 players and without two of his coaches.
Well, I'll tell you what, León are going to come out like gangbusters in that second half. Coming up, look out for León coming out of the dressing room the way they did in the first half back at Estadio Camp Nou in Guanajuato on Wednesday night. León are going to be up a man. If the scoreline ends as it stands, it would be León getting knocked out. The away goals rule obviously doesn't apply, as no team would have scored an away goal. It then goes to the old school tiebreaker. The secondary tiebreaker is the higher seed. So again, all sorts of crazy technicalities right now. If León were to get a goal, the away goals rule would then apply. Cholos would have to score two more and have a clean defensive slate for the rest of the evening and win this tie 5-1. Was the halftime whistle blown there moments ago? It was. Milton Caraglio knocked that one forward to Yarbrough. Yarbrough's just realizing now that the first half has concluded. And what a first half it was. They need a 3-0 result. Cholos lead 3-0 at halftime here at Estadio Caliente. If it ends like this, Los Cholos Quintles will miraculously move on to the semifinals of this Apertura Liguilla 2016. If we have half as much drama in that second half as we did in the first 45-plus, you should most definitely stick around. It's Cholos 3, León 0. We're back with the second half here on Azteca America San Diego. Stay tuned. Welcome back in to Estadio Caliente here in Tijuana, Baja California. What a first half we had. Are you ready for the second 45? Xolos back on even terms. 3-3 now the score on aggregate between Club Tijuana and the visitors, León from Guanajuato, after León won the first leg at their home stadium, the Nou Camp, on Wednesday night. 3-0. Xolos come back, say we got the same scoreline for you. If this holds as it stands right now, Xolos move on to the next round via being the higher seed. The higher seed tiebreaker carries them through. If León are to get a solitary goal here in this second 45, Xolos will have to score two more as the away goals rule takes effect as the first tiebreaker in this Apertura Liguilla. Halftime substitution for León will bring you real quick. Guillermo Berdizo, who was injured, taking that boot to the head from Aviles Hurtado right there at the end of the first half, bludgeoned. Really just a nasty sight seeing Berdizo leave the field. His evening is indeed over, and Juan Gonzalez, wearing the number 35, is in at center back to partner up with Diego Navarrete. My name is Nate Abaurea. A pleasure and a privilege to be with you here on Azteca America San Diego, coming to you the exclusive English language SAP coverage. Thank you so much for making Xolos and León part of your Saturday night plans. My broadcasting colleague Ivan Orozco sitting to my right. Ivan, if we have half as much drama here in this second half as we did in the first, it's going to be a mighty fun 45 minutes.
Oh, we can expect it to be an amazing second half. Based on the history between those teams, what's at stake? Reminding people, Club Tijuana is playing without his manager, without his assistant manager, and without Juninho. So we'll see how this plays out. I'm ready to have an exciting second half here, Nate.
Xolos went up 1-0 on a penalty kick from Dairo Moreno after losing their manager and assistant manager, Miguel Herrera and Diego Ramirez, respectively. They were up 1-0. They needed an early goal. They trailed 3-0 on aggregate coming into this game. They knew they needed goals. They knew they needed to be an attacking side. They got that early goal, but just 4 minutes later, Juninho was shown a straight red card for a nasty thigh-high challenge against Alexander Mejia. That saw Cholos reduced to 10 men with the one-goal advantage on the night, still needing two more goals at least in order to progress. Playing down a man, I swear, you wouldn't know who the team playing with the man advantage was in that first half. It looked like Cholos were still the fresher team, still the more energized team, and most definitely the more passionate side, backed by the chorus of La Masacre, backed by the passion of 27,000 strong here at Estadio Caliente. They went on to score twice more through Yasser Corona and Guido Rodriguez. It has the score where it stands right now. Cholos up 3-0 on the night. The marcador global, as they say in the English language, the aggregate, tied at 3. And again, if it stands like this for the rest of the night and we reach the final whistle with the same scoreline, it's the Cholos of Club Tijuana who advance to the semifinals, improbably, of this Liguilla in the Apertura 2016 season.
Right, and we started the night, the fireworks, if you can say, started when Miguel Herrera started protesting a foul that Guido Rodriguez committed on the play, and also a non-offside call. It started there with Herrera protesting and arguing. The whole bench cleared for Tijuana and started protesting too. The fire started from there, and it hasn't stopped since.
You know, it's important that you point out that challenge from Guido Rodriguez back in the seventh minute that kind of spawned the tirade there from Miguel Herrera against two of the referee's assistants that led to Herrera and his consigliere of sorts, Diego Ramirez, being shown their marching orders before we'd even played 10 minutes. They had left the field after about 9 minutes of played. Dairo Moreno scored that penalty kick moments later, and that was a chaotic moment in and of itself. But going back to what spawned the outrage of Miguel Herrera, Guido Rodriguez was shown a yellow card for that challenge. The way this formation is set up right now, Guido Rodriguez is essentially playing as a lone midfielder. For much of that first half, it was Guido Rodriguez basically bossing the entire midfield all on his own. The 22-year-old Argentine playing like he's 10 feet tall and has a world of experience. It was quite nice watching Guido Rodriguez work in that first half. Cholos, though, are in a whole lot of trouble here. It's cleared out part way. Cano back on it here on the byline. He wins. I thought he won a corner kick. I think Cano, turning back to the assistant there, thought that had deflected. You see Baselli looking at the referee, claiming just that.
That just came off the feet of Jacer Corona, who lost his balance there, or slipped to block that shot. Cholos got lucky there that Baselli didn't hold on to the ball and look for a different type of shot on that play.
Well, fortunate not only there, Ivan, with Baselli not being able to finish there, but it also looked as if very well could have been a corner kick in the end of it for León. But again, Guido Rodriguez, the lone center midfielder for the Cholos team, he's been on a yellow card since the seventh minute. So stay tuned to that storyline. You'd only imagine if Guido Rodriguez were shown a second yellow, the pressure that would put on the 9 remaining Cholos players on the field, and the spark that could give to the fire of La Fiera.
If anybody's questioning the guts
of Will,
that
could be a foul there on Guido Rodriguez, and very well could have been a yellow card on Guido Rodriguez. The referee just said play on.
Right. Guido escaped one there. But if people can question the will and the heart of this Tijuana players, as you saw Dairo Moreno sprint 20 yards up to the goal, the penalty box, and then another 50 yards to come back and defend. There's something we talked about earlier, that with 10 men, that's what they're going to have to do. And Moreno just going back up the field.
Well, and it can take a toll, too. We spoke about that in the first half. Once you get to minutes 70, 75, 80, and closing out this match, the end-to-end runs that these guys are making could very much take a toll, but that's where all the work in the conditioning department, where everybody's hoping it pays off right here tonight. This is where they need it, playing with 10 men since the 17th minute of this game. León, a big opportunity to get a goal here, and again, if they were to score just a single goal, the visitors from Guanajuato, Tijuana, would need to score two more and win 5-1 here this evening in order to advance to the semifinals. Defense over there on the far side by Nunez, but then falling asleep for a second. Now it's Yasser Corona giving chase. Corona, who scored the second goal. Close range finish past William Yarbrough. Goal that very much went to the credit of Damian Perez for the effort and energy that he put forth in order to get his team in to that attacking position. Corona just finished it off. And then Guido Rodriguez scoring for just the third time this season. Rodriguez with that third goal near the end of the first half. Aviles Hurtado cuts by one. Passes ahead to Dairo Moreno. It's 2v2 if Caraglio hurries here on this near side. Dairo goes at goal. William Yarbrough dives and saves. And this one is knocked back out. Big chance there for Dairo Moreno. 6.5 minutes in to this second half. Big save by the American-Mexican. Number 25, William Yarbrough. Pride of Aguascalientes. U.S. men's national team veteran who played in the youth ranks for the Mexican national team and had Mexico just cap-tied William Yarbrough. He very much could have been an El Tri goalkeeper fighting for a spot with the Mexican national team for the rest of his career. Look out, here is Federico Villar, watches this one go wide. Oh, it was a huge chance. Torrente on the sideline just turning away. It's out for a goal kick. See a replay here. It looked like Luis Montes, another former Mexican national team man, who headed that one wide in the end of it. Luis Montes, really a sad story, actually, going back to the summer of 2014. Luis Montes was a huge part of the Bicampeones teams under Gustavo Matosas for León, the teams that won the Apertura 2013 and Clausura 2014 championships back-to-back, beating America in that December 2013 final and beating Pachuca in May of 2014. Luis Montes was a huge factor in León's success, and it earned him a spot in the Mexican national team for the World Cup. Is this going to be a foul here?
Call the goal kick on that, no foul.
They just give the goal kick. There's two bodies still down here on the near side. Aviles Hurtado and the new man on the pitch, Juan Gonzalez, are down and getting back up. León just want to keep playing. You look at Javier Torrente saying, get up, let's go. Love the intensity from the León manager. And these are uncharted waters for León right now. In terms of since Torrente has been the manager, León have not been in a position like this. They have not hardly even trailed in a game since Torrente took over back in late August. William Yarbrough is now over in the corner, Ivan. Talking with Aviles Hurtado.
Hurtado says he took an elbow to the stomach, or to the lower midsection on that play. Let's see what happened. Oh, yeah, right there.
That's exactly what happened. Good eyes from way up here. My goodness. Did you cheat and use the monitor there?
Yes. And I could see him from down here, pointing to the stomach. Probably knocked the wind out of him. But Aviles Hurtado is up now, walking gingerly, slowly rubbing his stomach as he walks towards the other side of the field. Finishing. Team on the bench is as all the players warming up.
Finishing up real quickly, the attacking left-sided midfielder Luis Montes for León was a leg break in a friendly right before the 2014 World Cup, where he was going to go to Brazil. He was going to be part of Miguel Herrera's Mexico squad for that 2014 World Cup. A nasty leg break saw his career really put on hold.
And
Villar has that one knocked out of his hands by his own teammate. It looked like Cristobal Valenzuela. The gopher knocked it right out of the hands of Villar. See this on the replay here. Villar calling for it. And thankfully, Villar was heads up enough to reach back with the right arm and prevent that from going out for a corner kick. And what a priceless look on the faces.
What are you doing? Is what it looks like in his face.
Villar looking back up to Topo Valenzuela saying, hey, gopher. Don't do that, Nick. Don't do that next time. Unbelievable. Oh, could that be a foul on Milton Caraglio? It's a silly foul. It's an absolutely silly challenge for Milton Caraglio. A two-hand shove right to the back. Fernando Navarro Moran. And it's a set piece now for León.
He's from behind, too. That could be dangerous there.
It's not smart there for Milton Caraglio. Milton Caraglio, who cleared the ball off the line right at the end of the first half. Offside flag is up. Poor stuff from Leon. They refuse to capitalize on the gifted set piece there from Milton Caraglio. Offside flag up. Very much so. Again, Luis Montes, look out for him in this second half. Wearing the number 10, left-sided attacking midfielder, Mexican international, who has been some comeback story since that leg break back in June of 2014. A long and hard, difficult road just to get back to full fitness and helping this Leon team get hot at the right time, get streaky at the right time. But will that hot streak, that unbeaten run under new manager Javier Torrente, who took over a last-place team mid-season, will it come to an end this evening?
Talking about Montes, there's never an if or what could have happened in sports, but Montes not going to that World Cup. I wonder what could have happened in Mexico. You know, having him there, a guy who can play on the set pieces, long-range passes, speedy guy who can deliver balls from the midfield. Could have been interesting to see him play with El Tri in that World Cup.
Well, he was really in the form of his life going into that World Cup. That was the most heartbreaking aspect of that leg break, of that injury.
It was a nasty slide on that play, too. Both players just collided.
Remember, it was just leg to leg. It was a shatter break. It took a long time to recover. And anybody who's ever gone through an injury of that sort, you know how difficult it can be when there's a bone shatter involved. And that's exactly what happened to Luis Montes. So it's a testament to his courage, to his grit and determination. As now this one's to the back post. And was it Luis Montes who has it bounce off of a Cholos defender and goes out for a corner kick? Montes almost at the back post on cue, hearing his name called, saying, I'm ready to get my team back in front. He right. wins a corner kick at the back post. We see on the replay here, oh, it was a huge slide in there.
Nunez with the slide.
From Juan Carlos Nunez. That may have been a goal-saving challenge there from number 22.
But the threat isn't over. You got to remember who Leon scored on set pieces down in Bajio. So we'll see what happens
and
here.
And it's Montes to whip this one in, out swinging with the left foot. It's headed out. It's out for a throw over on the far side. Leon needing a goal to survive, to keep their season alive. They won the first leg 3-0. Cholos with just the most incredible first half. That one is misjudged quite a bit there by Yasser Corona. Flicks off the top of his head. It's out for a throw here on the near side. There has not been an away goal scored in either leg of this two-leg playoff encounter. If that changes, if Leon are to score an away goal, I mean, Cholos would have to score two more before the evening is over and keep things clean for the rest of the night defensively.
Should we try to explain that to our sports fans in San Diego, United States, who are not entirely soccer fans?
Well, we spoke about it earlier. The away goals rule is used as the first tiebreaker in these Liga playoffs, meaning that if the score is tied on the aggregate as it is right now, the away goals rule would be the first tiebreaker to send a team to the next round. Obviously, there has not been an away goal scored. So with it tied, you'd think, well, it would go to extra time. No, the Liga MX officials just want to confuse us a little bit more. From then, it goes to the secondary tiebreaker, which actually for years was the first tiebreaker in the Liga MX playoffs. And that is that the higher seed advances. So if the away goals is level, the higher seed then actually gets to advance to the next round. So as it stands right now, that's Cholos advancing on that second tiebreaker, being that there hasn't been a road team to score a goal in either of these two games.
I think we need to explain what aggregate means. That means it's the total combined score between the two matches in the series, a home and away series. You know, and with the first team playing away, second team playing at home, total of those goal scores is the aggregate.
We have a substitute here coming on for Cholos. It looks like Malcora is entering the game. Talk about a guy who's found quality form late in the season. Fine example of it, Victor Malcora. He comes in for Aviles Hurtado. Aviles Hurtado plays about an hour this evening. He was all over the park. He didn't play the full match back on Wednesday night. He was subbed off in the 77th minute by Miguel Herrera back in Guanajuato. He subbed off in the 60th minute here this evening. Malcora on to very much give Guido Rodriguez some help in the center of the park. Look for Malcora to drift a little bit more central, but it's Malcora actually making a huge run, trying to Dairo Moreno to see him. Moreno was knocked in the face and had it knocked away from him. And now Leon carry forward. Caraglio wins the challenge, but this one eventually is launched forward and It's going to be collected by Federico Villar. 61st minute. Cholos just need a half hour more of this, and they will advance somehow, some way, to the semifinals of this Apertura 2016 Liguilla, after trailing 3-0 coming in to this second leg. Malcora out with a vengeance. Fresh out of the frying pan and into the fryer, Victor Malcora flying all over the place. It was certainly a foul. He's kind of sending a message there as Juan Gonzalez, the man who came in for the injured Guillermo Burdizzo, took a cleat to the face, was bludgeoned by the boot of Aviles Hurtado. We also should point out, actually, that challenge that knocked Burdizzo out of the game, it saw Aviles Hurtado rightfully receive a yellow card. So Aviles was on a yellow there, being withdrawn moments ago for Victor Malcora. It's a chance at the back post. It's saved by Villar. Federico Villar says Estadio Caliente, exhale, I gotcha. Watch the replay here. It flicked through, and at the back post, was it Luis Montes heading down into the hands of Federico Villar? It was. Montes coming in. Villar goes down, holds strong, and Cholos stay in front in a way. Again, the aggregate score currently tied. But if it stays this way, it'll suit the Cholos Cuitlace just fine as they will advance to the semifinals. Malcora fouled down here in the corner. And a chance for Tijuana. Maybe send a couple of guys up and go after a fourth. Got to be careful here again. They're playing down a man. They've been down a man since the 17th minute when Juninho was sent off for that studs over challenge on Alexander Mejia. Malcora is going to whip this one in, out swinging with the left foot. Milton Caraglio running around trying to stay loose inside the 18. Five in the box in red.
Yeah, Caraglio hiding behind Guido Rodriguez on this play.
It's a good ball that's towards Milton Caraglio. Cholos got to be smart here. Leon are one of the best counter-attacking teams in all the land. This one eventually goes all the way back to Federico Villar. Coming up on 18 minutes played here in this second half. Milton Caraglio chests this one down. Dairo Moreno nods it back to Milton. Caraglio playing with his back to goal the way he does oh so well. Tries to crack a shot with the left foot. Ends up as a okay pass over to Malcora. Malcora to Yasser Corona. Yasser Corona. Did he win a corner there? The referee is saying a throw-in. The ball actually whipped right in to the corner flag, knocked it out of the ground. And they say that it went out on the touchline side of the corner flag. We're quickly back underway. Caraglio with his back to goal inside the 18. Now wins the corner kick for Cholos.
You see Caraglio backing up there like a power forward, protecting the ball, trying to turn, make a turn, find somebody he can distribute the ball to or flick it over the air and try to get somebody to head it in. But that's one thing that Caraglio has right now is his size over some of these defenders as he tries to post up inside the box.
It's a great sporting analogy, Ivan, as far as the way that he plays with his back to goal. Very much reminds you of a low post presence on the basketball court. Milton Caraglio, also a guy who can go up for aerial challenges with the best of them. He scored a few with the head this season for Cholos. Oh, how big one would be tonight. A guy who's scored quite a few with his head for Leon. Knocked that one out there moments ago, Mauro Boselli. Boselli, in fact, scored the first goal back on Wednesday night. A thunderous header in the 12th minute. Look out here as Yasser Corona is in an attacking position. He tries a blind back heel back to Dairo Moreno. It doesn't come off. Dairo not happy. Leon counterattacking. They've got numbers, and that one is just scuffed. It's a tough break there. Diego Novaretti was pushing way up. The Argentine center back for Leon and had a big chance to play Luis Montes out wide or maybe knock up to somebody on the right side. Instead, just completely scuffed the attempt and hit it straight to Villar.
I think that's one of the things that Leon is lacking tonight. A little bit of patience, a little bit of just waiting around to see if he can get a clear shot. They're trying to get the ball out as quickly as they can when they can have some time and find some other players on the field that can make plays.
And on cue right there, that's just lackadaisical there.
That's what we're talking about.
Leonel Lopez Gonzalez being yelled at by a few of his teammates. And like that moment there, he's coming up to have a quick conversation is Christian Valdez, who actually entered this game as a substitute for Mejia, who was injured back in that first half. So Leon have already used two substitutes in this game. They are about to make their final switch. We look down onto the touchline. That's Maximiliano Morales, who entered the game back on Wednesday night as a 79th minute substitute for Mauro Boselli. I do not think that Mauro Boselli is going to be withdrawn from this game with Leon needing a goal. It's as simple as that. Leon have to score. The way these circumstances have changed oh so much, it's Leon who must score a goal. Malcora looking to give a fourth to Cholos. It's across the face. What a stop there by Yarborough. Like he's got stickum on the gloves. Yarborough rolls out and Leon head back on their way. Pushing forward. It's Elias Hernandez. Hernandez has got plenty of time and space. There's a lot of red shirts back, but nobody closing down on number eight. Leon slowing things down, getting numbers forward. Again, they have to score. It's quite that simple. It's that simple. They got to score a goal. Where's the urgency for Leon? This one's overhit. It's back out wide. It's knocked forward by Damian Perez. What a night here at Estadio Caliente again. Nate Abarrea and Ivan Orozco here with you. The exclusive English language coverage. Azteca America San Diego, pleasure and a privilege to be with you. Take this thing home. 23 minutes plus added time remaining in this contest. There will be no extra time. The way these playoffs are designed, there will be a winner somehow, some way after 90 minutes are played this evening. There are a couple of bodies down near the midfield line. Leon just continue playing, and now a referee
is that Damian Perez on the ground?
Blows his whistle. Santander comes over to check on Damian Perez. It is indeed Damian Perez down on the ground there. It was a nasty challenge.
His right leg just buckled and bent there a little bit in that challenge.
So Damian Perez not only took the brunt of that thing for the legs, but also kind of face-planted right into the artificial turf. Substitution for Leon. We'll bring you this real quickly. Leonel Lopez Gonzalez. Leon is withdrawn from the game as an attacking-minded midfielder. Maximiliano Morales comes into the game. You see another Argentine-to-Argentine conversation happening there on the touchline between Javier Torrente and his center back, Diego Novaretti, the number six, former Belgrano youth product and a man who played for Toluca for five seasons. Now, one of the anchors of that Leon back line, Diego Novaretti, talking things over with his manager. Where's the passion going to come from? Where's that moment of brilliance going to come from? Or will it be a lucky break for Leon? Will it be a moment of fortune for Leon to get what is now a vital goal, a much-needed goal, a mandatory goal? It looks like we are going to have another substitution for Cholos.
Right, the cart takes Perez out.
Damian Perez is coming out, entering the game. It's going to be Henry Martin. Actually, I take that back. Milton Caraglio is withdrawn. Damian Perez is back up on his feet.
Striker for striker coming in here.
Okay, this makes a little bit more sense now, as Damian Perez was taken off on the cart, but now he's just having a bottle of water and talking things over with his teammates on the sideline. And Damian Perez says, I'm ready to go back in. Let me in. Milton Caraglio drawn here in the 70th minute. Henry Martin, the number 11 on to replace him. Miguel Herrera is not on the touchline right now. Neither is his assistant, Diego Ramirez. They're down to 10 men. They're also up 3-0 on the night. And again, in case you're just joining us, the scoreline holds. Cholos advance to the next round. Look out, header into the hands of Villar. Federico holds on for dear life. It was a good ball in from Efrain Velarde. And it was Montes again. Luis Montes has been all over this second half. Will he be the guy to score the goal that sends Leon through to the next round? For the 10 Cholos players on the field right now against the 11 of León, miraculously hold on to this 3-0 lead, this 3-3 tie on aggregate, and advance via the tiebreaker of being the higher seed, the 1 seed as opposed to the 8 seed, here in these Mexican League playoffs. Not to get too crazy with these hypotheticals, but if Cholos were to score and go up 4-0, the objective would still be exactly the same for León. A 4-1 win for Cholos this evening would actually see León advance via the away goals tiebreaker that we spoke of earlier.
Right, that's the advantage the visiting team has. You can score less goals and still win, still advance.
Now Cora with the left foot, driven low, headed down and out by Buscelli. Forwards back defending this evening. It's been a theme. Argentine forwards, no less.
With so many Argentine players on the field, chances are quite high there, Nate.
You pretty much, you look at the rosters of these two teams and even look at the main man on the touchline, Javier Torrente. Such a strong Argentine presence here in this matchup. But this is an authentically Mexican rivalry. Two teams with no love lost for one another. A matchup, a rivalry that has nothing to do with geography or anything like that. Look out here! Oh, it goes just wide! Huge chance for León! A beautiful ball! And a nod back across
Navarro
from Fernando Navarro Moran. He was onside. He made a brilliant run past Dairo Moreno, and he tried to play it back across the face to Buscelli, to the man who you would want in that position, and Buscelli just couldn't get on the end of it. Another collective sigh of relief here at Estadio Caliente. These Cholos fans are beginning to sense it, beginning to feel it. The chance of Cholos, 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 come. 27,000 strong down below us. And Nate Abarrea and Ivan Orozco here with you. Coming to you from way high above the playing surface here at Estadio Caliente. We got 17 minutes of the 90 to go. Plus certainly a few minutes of added time. Can Cholos hold on? Is this going to be a goal kick or a corner? It'll be the latter. Pardon me, the prior. It's a goal kick.
Line just pointed to the goal kick. Now we see León trying to pick up his lines, moving forward, looking for that goal that put him in the semifinals. I'm interested to see how whoever's coaching down on the bench for Cholos, I think it's Rangel, that's up right now, chooses to bring in a player to play more defensive-minded game, but they didn't. They brought in Henry Martin, a striker. It looks like Auche might come in, too, and continue that offensive effort.
Well, you've actually got Michael Orozco on the bench, but it looks like Auche is going to come into this game. So surprising there. Auche, who is a more attack-minded player, but as we've seen this season, Auche is someone who can pitch in defensively, get gritty in the center of the park, and that's certainly what he's going to be asked to do more than anything here for the remainder of this game.
He might come on Vidal Moreno over on that side.
A midfielder, right, midfielder for a forward, definitely a possibility. As this one is knocked away and carrying on is Elias Hernandez. Over to Efraín Velarde. Wide now. Luis Montes. Montes, beautiful ball chip forward for Velarde. Velarde continues fighting through. What a ball that was there moments ago.
Montes is quite a player, Nate.
Oh my goodness. Luis Montes has just been electric in the second half, doing it all, trying to be the guy to light the spark for León. They just need one goal against a 10-man Cholos team, and they will advance to the semifinals. Will it come, or will Cholos hold on? León pressing forward, holding possession in the attacking third. This one's headed out. Played 75 and change here in Baja California. Will there be more playoff soccer for these fans in Tijuana and San Diego come next week? Or will this be the last game of an incredible season? If León score one more, it will. Boselli heads down. Should say if León score one at all this evening. They scored three on Wednesday night. They can't buy a goal this evening. No foul. Physical play. It's going to be quite physical for the remainder of this contest. It was a great run here on this near side by Elias Hernandez. His teammate never saw him. Out wide here. Fernando Navarro-Moran, the right back, pushing up into the thick of this thing. Maxi Morales on it now. Spinning. Oh, beautiful footwork from Luis Montes. This one's poked out wide. Good stuff from León. It's to the back post. It's knotted back. Oh, thought they were going to go with goal there. This one is now still alive. Montes heads down. No offside flag up. It's poked back into the hands of Villar. Unbelievable. You look down at the crowd around us right now, Ivan. There's people scratching their heads, wiping their foreheads, exhaling. People just straight up throwing their hands in the air, palms to the heavens, saying, please, 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 quarter of an hour more. Please, please, please. Whoever is overseeing this game up in the sky, just let us finish 3-0. That's all we're asking. Unbelievable.
What a match. This is what playoff atmosphere is all about. Even if there's not a goal, that play right there just took the breath out of an entire stadium and other people on the bench. And here comes a substitute, and it is Auche for Dairo Moreno here.
It was a good call there moments ago, Ivan. You talked about Dairo coming out of this game. Dairo's going to take his sweet, merry old time walking to the touchline right now. As you see, Luis Enrique Santander Aguirre saying, I'm going to chaperone you to the touchline because otherwise you're just going to walk all the way there. It's Auche, a midfielder, replacing a forward, Dairo Moreno. And you look at Dairo with the blonde hair waving as he jogs off the pitch, just pumping this crowd up all night. This performance from Dairo Moreno this evening has been just as much about what he's done emotionally to the men on the field and the men, women, and children in the stands as much as what he's contributed actually between the touchline, on and off the ball.
Right, and that substitution there is an offensive-minded substitution. Tijuana wants to keep moving the ball, keep in control. Don't give León a chance to, with one set piece, one play, one quick play, score that goal that can put him in the semifinals.
It's a nice middle ground of a substitution, really, when you see what Auche's done all season long. When you've watched Cholos all season long, you know what Auche can offer. Obviously, he is a more attack-minded center-attacking midfielder, so to speak, but he does know how to just be a gritty center-of-the-park kind of guy, and he is going to be tasked with quite a bit of defensive duties as we carry out the remainder of this game. Obviously, a little bit more defensive-minded automatically, being that Dairo Moreno plays exclusively as a forward out there, the number 17. Juan Gonzalez was taken to the ground, and now the foul is called. Yarborough was out for this thing, took a big whiff at it. The whistle finally comes. Cholos fans had no idea. They thought the thing was live the entire time. The ball ended up wide. It would not have counted. Yarborough is saying, please, you should have let me know.
Right, he's pointing at the scoreboard at the clock, saying, look at the time. We don't have time to waste with a place like this.
León definitely seen the urgency pick up. Javier Torrente is by no means the most animated manager in the world. He's actually one of the most stoic skippers that you're going to find. Villar fumbles that one but grabs it. 11 minutes of the 90 remaining. Torrente, to talk about a real poker player down there as a gaffer. A true even-keeled kind of head coach. Torrente getting about as animated as you're ever going to see him down on the touchline right now, as León, again, just need one goal to advance. They had a three-goal lead coming into this game. The only scoreline could have gotten Cholos through. Shouldn't say the only scoreline, but scoreline that people were going for was León losing 3-0. Cholos getting a 3-0 victory and advancing via the secondary higher seed tiebreaker. We've said it before, we'll say it again, as we now have 10 minutes remaining in this 90. If this score holds somehow, some way, the men in red, black, and white playing with 10 men, they would advance to the next round. The 11 in green and white are still pressing, and they've scored! It's Mauro Boselli heading past Villar. León back in front, and Cholos
now must score two more. 36th minute of the second half, 81st minute of the game. Mauro Boselli, the 31-year-old Argentine, the former Boca Juniors youth product. He heads home past his fellow countrymen. He just out-jumped Topo Valenzuela, caught the Xolos back line sleeping. Mauro Boselli, the main man in Guanajuato, may have just sent León to the next round. Unbelievable. What a night we've had here in Tijuana. And that is just a gut-wrenching twist in the plot for 27,000 strong here at Estadio Caliente. It's not over just yet, but now it's another huge mountain to climb for Xolos, playing with 10 men after making a number of defensive-minded substitutions. Now it's Xolos who need to score two goals to advance.
Right, that goal right there just deflated the stadium. We'll see how the Xolos respond to that. But if you take a look, if we show another replay on this of this goal, how easy it was for León to send that cross into the area for Boselli to head it in. The player was unmarked there. It's similar to what happened in León, where León was able to send in set pieces at ease.
Ivan, we've seen so many times in the second half, we've just been holding our breath. Talk about the collective exhale of Estadio Caliente. How many times Villar just looked down and said, oh my goodness, how did the ball end up in my hands there? How are we still holding this clean sheet? And you're just asking yourself, well, how many more of these are they going to get away with? Well, there's your answer.
Right. And it's something that's what playoff soccer is about. You know, it doesn't matter how you score and when they come in, but as long as you get them in the net, counts. 4-3 aggregate for León. This puts him in the semifinals despite Tijuana's effort to take that 3-0 lead in the first half. We'll see how they respond to that after with some confusion here going on the field. It's going to be a bounce of free. León's going to keep the ball there. Fair play there, giving it back to Tijuana.
Selly knocks it up to Villar. 7 minutes of the 90 remaining. Xolos already had one miracle tonight with a three-goal first half. Two of those goals coming after Juninho had already been sent off in the 17th minute. It was a minor miracle at the least in that first half. They need an absolute miracle to close out. And look out, it could be Boselli to finish this thing off. It's up and over from Cano. Oh, that would have been the nail in the coffin, surely. And somehow, some way, Xolos are still alive. By the skin of their teeth, the chin of their chinniest chin chins, Xolos are still alive in these Liga MX playoffs. But again, they still need two goals here in these final few minutes. This place was absolutely crushed by that goal from Boselli. If León get another here, which they do, and it's the man of this second half, Luis Montes, that is surely curtains for the season for Club Tijuana. Luis Montes, he's been electric in this second half. Arguably the best player on the pitch since the restart. The former Mexican international who's had such an incredible comeback story after that gut-wrenching leg break back in 2014. He's paved a long, difficult, and strenuous road back to full health, back to full fitness, and back to fine form. And it pays dividends. A karmic finish, you must say, to Montes' performance in this second half. He's deserved that goal with the way he's played in this second 45. Tough break for Federico Villar as that one went right between the wickets, right through the legs of the 39-year-old Argentine goalkeeper who some say could be in his final season as the goalkeeper for Xolos. We'll get to that, obviously, during the off season. Right now, see Xolos fans trying to show love to their players. La Masacre never waning when it comes to their noise. But surely, the season is drawing to a close here. What a season it was. A season it still is. A few minutes left in this thing.
But León are surely heading to the semifinals of this Apertura Liguilla. The traveling fans from Guanajuato up in the corner.
They're having a real good time.
Hopefully everybody can behave themselves on the way out of this place tonight, because there are, just say, some high-running tensions around the stadium right now. The Cholos players, you see on the touchline, the likes of Dairo Moreno and Milton Caraglio, they just can't believe it. They're withdrawn from this game, and as Cholos went to a far more defensive style, obviously with 10 men, out of necessity very much so, but they go to that real bunker-oriented style to try to close this thing out and hold on to the 3-0 lead. Eventually, the bunker was not enough. Eventually, the wall gave way, and Baselli headed past Villar, and just minutes later, Luis Montes put one right between the wickets of Villar to make the score 3-2, 5-3 on aggregate in favor of León. Baselli with the bicycle kick that goes into the hands of Federico Villar. 3.5 minutes of the 90 remaining. Auche, bad first touch. This one's knocked out into touch. Throw in for Cholos on the far side, Nunez to take.
It was a phenomenal season from Tijuana. I mean, being the number one seed, you know, clinching that top spot with 33 points. But there's a saying in Mexico that that number one seed has the curse when it comes to the playoffs, when the number one seed usually gets eliminated in the last few seasons here.
Spoke about this with some journalistic colleagues a couple of days ago, including a couple of folks who are stationed down in Mexico City and the people who actually cover León routinely throughout the season. We're having a laugh saying, well, the last time that León got hot late in the season, snuck into the playoffs in the eighth spot, well, you know, all they did was win the championship. And here they are again, very much looking like they could be well on their way to another title, the way they're playing. Obviously, it was not easy tonight. William Yarbrough cuts back and launches that one clear. It was by no means clean. It was filled with intensity, pressure, and quite a bit of nervousness, as it looked like the Cholos of Club Tijuana may be the ones to improbably go through after losing the first leg 3-0. Scored three goals in the first half. Lead 3-0 on this night. The aggregate tied at 3. With the away goals non-existent at that time, it was Cholos who would have gone through had the scoreline ended 3-0 in favor of Tijuana here this evening. Unfortunately for these fans who love their dogs of this northern border town oh so much and have given everything they have as supporters throughout this season, looks like this night that's just been a wild topsy-turvy roller coaster ride, looks like the final turn, it's a real disappointing one. This is going to be one of the bitterest pills to swallow for this Cholos team, for these Cholos fans. What a season it was. What an effort it was this evening, playing with 10 men for the majority of this game. That one goes just wide. Did Villar get a fingertip on it? No. Maxi Morales was pleading for it.
Right, what a match tonight. Two different tails in each half.
That header up there, we're watching the replay right now. That's going back to that critical goal that was scored by Baselli. It was Juan Gonzalez actually getting up for that initial flick that then led to the subsequent cross from the back post that was headed home by Baselli. Juan Gonzalez, who was only in this game because Guillermo Berthizo was absolutely bludgeoned by the flying foot of Aviles Hurtado back in the 45th minute at the end of the first half. Juan Gonzalez, if it wasn't for that injury, he wouldn't be on the field right now. And he ends up playing a critical role in helping León advance through this incredible two-leg tie. Get these two goals back late that are going to be the difference. To send La Fiera, the wild beast, Las Esmeraldas, the green bellies of Guanajuato. It looks like León are going to be heading to the semifinals of this Liguilla here in the 2016 Apertura. We've played 45 minutes. There will be just 2 minutes of added time. Ivan Orozco, got to ask you, before we leave here tonight, how would you sum up this Cholo season? First place in the regular season, 33 points. A fantastic run in the regular season.
but it ends in bitter disappointment. The curse of the one seed continues in the Liga MX playoffs.
If I would use one word, probably disappointing, in the sense that for Tijuana, they had all the tools, everything they needed as the number one seed to break that curse for once, especially the way they played during the season, that 11 unbeaten game streak run, unbeaten at home until the final home match against Tigres, and having the depth on the bench to be able to play in these type of matches. But like Herrera said, Miguel Herrera said earlier in the week, if you don't control the ball, if you don't have possession, you don't win. And that's what happened with Tijuana this evening in the second half. That more defensive mindset, although you had 10 men on the field, kind of bit back at them for not keeping the same mentality they had in the first half.
I'll tell you what, if Cholos had come out tonight, tied 1-1, maybe 1-2-1, had an even game, 11-11, it almost wouldn't hurt as much as it hurts right now for these Cholos fans, because you saw the fight, you saw the grit and courage from this Cholos team, and it just came up agonizingly short in the end of it. 10 men working all night, the substitutes that came in as well. So much determination, so much courage shown by these Cholos players. Carry on down a man from the 17th minute on and still score two more goals in that first half to make it 3-0. We talked about how tired legs and tired minds may play a role late on. They most definitely did, as those goals from Mauro Bas-